Good morning. Let us briefly revise what we achieved so far. We are trying to classify the unitary representations of the Heisenberg group, and we need for this to make equivalence up to intertwining operators, so unitary equivalence for unitary representations. So we are looking for operators which intertwine two representations which may appear differently but are essential up to that unitary isometry. we look for orbit method of Kirillov for it, and we notice what our representations considered so far was built by means of induction, and we induce from a character. And for character, we may associate this character with the element of the dual to the Lie algebra of the Heisenberg group. So when character is given by such an exponent as in formula 4t, when action, conjoint action on the dual space to the Lie algebra of the group G will produce the collection of intertwining operators between induced representation. And as a consequence, any representation generated by different linear functionals belonging to the same orbit will be unitary equivalent. For Heisenberg group, we made this calculation, and we find out what coadjuvant action on the linear functionals, which we parameterize by parameters h, which will be identified with the Planck constant, and q and p, which are physically meaningful as coordinate and momentum of a particle. For such a linear functional, coadjuvant orbits are given by the hyperplane with the same value of Planck constant, and the q and p parameters can be eliminated by coadjuvant action. So all inductions actually can be done by characters which produced by linear functional with Planck constant 0, 0. So here is the picture which we had. We have that hyperspace, and we identified the all orbits with Planck constant different from zero with one single representation of the Heisenberg group, and points of the hyperplane with h equal to zero will be elements of the will be corresponding points of the physical phase space. When we made an agreement for the physical units, and this agreement is about the obvious observation what there is no way to add physical quantities which are of different dimensionality. We can add only things which are both measured, say, in meters, not in meters and seconds. And mathematical functions like exponent, sine, cosine, other things related to Taylor expansion are naturally defined only for dimensionless quantities. And that suggests what our elements of the Heisenberg group, coordinate x, y, and s, shall be shall have units which are reciprocal to the action, physical action corresponding to the Planck constant, coordinate, and momentum, q and p. So this is the agreement which we will follow in our presentation for the rest of the course. When we build a representation which is connected to the coadjuvant action of the Heisenberg group, so we come to the this coadjuvant action which we discussed before. So this is a coadjuvant action here, and we try to make an induction using coadjuvant orbit as the homogeneous space. And this is indeed possible. Representation which we will obtain is related to the previous Fock-Segal-Bargmann representation considered before. So I recall what we did in the corresponding parts. So we had the Fock-Segal-Bargmann type representation which act on the homogeneous space obtained by factorization by equivalence class of the Heisenberg group with respect to its center, and that was the representation given by the formula 32. Now we apply so-called Fourier-Kirilov transform. So the formula for Fourier-Kirilov transform will be the integral for function f depending on a variable on the group will be given by minus 2 pi I. And here we have a pairing between vector field x and f with integration over the corresponding vector field x, and our integral is taken over the Lie algebra G, and here x an element of the Lie algebra G, and f belong to its dual. So that will produce a function f depending on that functional f capital. And then making such a transform, Fock-Segal-Bargmann transform for the case Fock-Segal-Bargmann transform for the previously considered representation, we obtain the following expression. The Fourier transform which we considered will send variables x, y to the Fourier dual variables q and p on the phase space. So that coordinates in the phase space. And that formula for Fourier transform which we have here acting between these two set of variable will intertwine the, so Fourier transform will intertwine the action in the equation 32 and the our formula in the equation 42. So that two formulas are intertwined by such a Fourier transform. And similarly, we may consider the Fourier transform between variables x and q, and consider the Fourier transform of this pair of dual variables, then equation 34 will be intertwined by this Fourier transform with our equation 33. So just performing a Fourier transform will produce the following form of the representation for the Heisenberg group. It's again easy to see. If you will count dimensionality as was described before, you will see that all addition of variables here is done correctly according to the dimensionality assigned before. Now, having a representation of a continuous group, of a Lie group, we may apply a certain standard operation. One of the such operation is analytical, it's taking derivative. So I recall that the for element of Lie algebra X, we may consider it as a generator of one parameter continuous subgroup, so that one parameter continuous subgroup satisfies the group homomorphism from the additive group of real numbers to our group, in particular case Heisenberg group. And for such a generator, we may consider, because exponentiation of Tx will belong to the group, so we may, for a representation of the group, we may consider that as a bounded or even unitary operator on our vector space V. When that operator is a function of variable t, a strongly continuous function, in a suitable sense that function can be differentiated with respect to variable t, and we may substitute value of variable t equal to zero. So if such expression will be evaluated not for representation rho, but for left regular representation, for example, we already used that formula to obtain left or right invariant vector fields on the corresponding group. Now for the representation rho, corresponding value will be depending only on the x element of the Lie algebra, so we get a so-called derived representation of the respective Lie algebra G. So here is a couple of examples, and they illustrate the issues which we may have in that relation. So if our group is again group of reals with addition, and representation is done by multiplication with a character, then using the formula 44, we will find what the derived representation is just multiplication by that parameter A, real number A, which defines the character. If we will take the equivalent representation, which given by a shift operator, then that is equivalent again by means of Fourier transform. Fourier transform is intertwining operator between these two representations. But this time derived representation produced the derivative. And derivative is unbounded operator if we will consider it on the corresponding Hilbert space L2 over real line. So we need to make sense of this unbounded operator, considering its domain to be some nice space of function. The best possible choice probably is the space of the Schwarz functions. So we consider the smooth, fastly decreasing function at infinity. Another analytical operation which is possible to do in continuation with the group is integration. So for integration, we need to take for integration to be nicely connected with the group structure, we need to pick up an invariant measure. That measure such what shift by arbitrary element of a set will preserve the measure of this set. But if our group is non-commutative, shift from the left and shift from the right may be a different operation, and measure which is invariant under left shift not necessarily is invariant under right shift. So for groups which has measure invariant under both left and right shift, there is a special name, which is important class of unimodular group. Otherwise, that left invariant and right invariant measures are absolutely continuous with respect one to another, and so they are connected by some function, as it's known from the Radon-Nikodym theorem, and that function is called modular function. So unimodular function means what this function is constantly equal to one. There are large classes of unimodular functions, that is, say, commutative or compact group. The Heisenberg group is unimodular as well. Moreover, the invariant measure is the Lebesgue measure on corresponding Euclidean space and corresponding exponential coordinates, so that make integration straightforward on the Heisenberg group. Again, for non-unimodular group, you don't need to go too far to have an example. AX plus B group, which we already considered, is in a case of a group which is not unimodular. When for the left invariant measure, collection of left shift will be an isometry in obvious way on any LP space. So if we will consider action on LP space on the group, left shift by invariance of the measure will produce isometric operations. Once we have shift and we have integration, the normal typical situation will be to consider convolution. So convolution is given by equation 45. Again, that expression is very straightforward generalization of usual convolutions given by the integrals on the real line. So I recall what convolution of two functions f1 and f2 on a real line will be defined in the standard way as the integral of f1 of variable s times f2 t minus s integration with respect to s. So as you can see, that formula for the convolution on the real line is straightforwardly generalized for any other group which has an invariant left invariant measure. It's easy to see what if we have a function from L1, then convolution will be a bounded operator on L2. So it's again just an application of the Fubini theorem to make an estimation what the L2 norm of the convolution KF is bounded by L1 norm of K and L2 norm of function F. Correspondingly, if we consider convolution as an operation of some Gilbert space, we may consider composition of these operators, and again, composition of two convolution will be a convolution with the function which is a convolution of corresponding kernels. So convolutions may so-called L1 Banach algebra. So L1 on the group will form a Banach algebra. Furthermore, we may integrate a function together with representation. So that will be called integrated representation for our functions. that integral need to be understood in a proper sense. So in particular, one of the possibilities to understand that integral would be the integration or in the weak sense. So to obtain the operator rho of k, we consider it as to be defined through the identity what rho k act on vector u paired to functional v, as when we are taking the integration over entire group G of the k of G and the corresponding action of a unitary representation rho G on u paired with v dg. So that will be the definition in so-called weak sense. nice property is what integrated representation is actually is a representation of corresponding Banach algebra L1 of convolution. We have here the corresponding homomorphism from the convolution operation on the group to the product of operator in corresponding representation space. Now we are prepared to introduce the main tool of our consideration. We will look for a so-called covariant transform. The covariant transform is defined in rather general terms for, again, some representation rho, a linear representation, and some group, not necessary even topological group, acting on the space V. We will need an operator from representation space V to some other vector space U, when covariant transform is given by the formula 47. So to understand that formula a bit, we will say that here F is need to be at least positively homogeneous, namely for positive real numbers T, we will need homogeneity conditions. But of course, if F is a linear operator, then we will have even nicer property for covariant transform. Also, the purpose of this covariant transform, as you can see, it sends vector from a vector space V, which may be an some abstract vector space, to a particular space of function on the group G. So they realize element of the vector space V as function on the group, and they produce a good realization. Of course, that function is with the value in the vector space U, and the simplest case will be if our functions are scalar valued. To this end, F shall be, let's say, for example, linear functional on U. So in this situation, our definition will produce most useful. We may look for the main property of the covariant transform. Covariant transform is intertwining operator between the given representation rho, which we are investigating, and the canonical left invariant representation. So this is the main property of covariant transform, which have numerous applications. Just to prove that property, you don't need more than four lines. So according to the definition, the action of covariant transform on the vector acted by the representation rho is given by this expression. Now, because rho is representation, we use homomorphism property and put these two operators together. Then clearly we have expression for the covariant transform of the element of group G inverse H, and then that is just the left shift of the covariant transform defined by the formula which we had before. So that intertwining property will be used on many occasions. Now we may look for the most common example of a covariant transform. It's known as a wavelet transform. Well, because object appeared in many different situations, the names, there are many different names for the transform. It's known as the cogerent transform in quantum mechanics. Signal processing, we prefer to use language of wavelet transform, and so forth. So in our situation, so wavelet transform appears as follow. We have a representation which is a unitary in a Hilbert space V, and fiducial vector which is used for the covariant transform is just a linear functional which assign to a vector some corresponding scalar defined by V naught. When the expression for wavelet transform will be easily transformed to several equivalent form. So in this way we will obtain scalar valued function on the group G. And the most famous group for producing this type of transformation is the affine group. So we already met affine group on several occasions. So I recall it has components AB, A and positive real, B with just real number. Multiplication is obtained by composition of affine transformation of the real line. When a representation is a metric representation in the LP space is given by the corresponding affine transformation of the variable and this character in front which make the transformation an isometry. When corresponding for mother wavelet, so-called mother wavelet phi, the corresponding wavelet transform is given by integral on the real. It's interesting to mention what wavelet transform construction appeared not only in the applicable areas like signal processing, quantum mechanics, as Cauchy transform, but also in very pure areas of mathematics like a complex analysis. So let us consider the above construction for the particular case of the mother wavelet to be 1 over x plus I. Here we will use a different expression, slightly different expression for our wavelet transform, just applying a different element of the group. So on the slide we have put the inverse to be AB, but we now make the transformation for G being element AB itself, when G inverse on the AX plus B group will be as easy to calculate 1 over A and minus B over A. So group multiplication on AX plus B group of these two elements will produce, as easy to check, is just 1, 0, scaling by 1, shift by 0. This is the group unit for the affine group. Now we apply the wavelet transform according to the formula. So that will be F rho AB applied to our mother wavelet. So that is integral over R, so we may put square root of A here for square integrable unitary representation when we have a product of fx with the complex conjugation of the mother wavelet. So we take complex conjugation 1 and in function we are making the transformation which would correspond to this element. So we have x minus b over a plus I dx. Now we take complex conjugation, so that changes the sign. We have a integral over f r fx. So we have 1 x minus b minus I times a, and we have, if I will not forget it, a in the numerator dx. So that will be square root of a to the power 3, if we will count all a's, r f x over x minus b plus I A dx, or if you want, it will be square root of A cube integral f x x minus z dx. This is exactly the Cauchy formula. This is exactly the Cauchy formula, where z is an element of the upper half plane corresponding to the b plus I a. So we have here b to be any real number, a is positive real number, so collection of points which is considered is the upper half plane. So really the affine group is behind of a lot of complex analysis which is done on the upper half plane, and that wavelet transform produce the Cauchy integral formula which map a function defined on the real line to the function defined on the affine group, which is upper half plane in our case. Let us take a look how the wavelet transform can be written for the Heisenberg group and Schrödinger representation. So taking Schrödinger representation 30, equation 34, we can write down the integral, which is in a product, on the real line of a given function f with some selected Mother wavelet v naught. For many reasons, as we will see later, it's convenient to choose as Mother wavelets the Gaussian. This is exponent minus x square, which is suitably normalized, so we put factor minus pi Planck constant in order to have total integral, total L2 norm over the real line equal to normalized value. When for this particular Mother wavelet, the wavelet transform will be explicitly written as such an integral as in formula 33. And we will see what here the central part of the Heisenberg group, the element S, just act as a multiplication by a certain constant. So for many practical purposes, this action may be discarded, and it's convenient to take just a representation of Mother wavelets with the coordinate 0, x, y. That situation has some more general setup. So coming back to the general form of the covariant transform in formula 47, we may see what there is a special case where we pick up certain subgroup H tilde. This subgroup H tilde may coincide or may be different with the subgroup H, which we have already used in order to induce our representation. So for such a subgroup H tilde, we consider Mother wavelet, which has a similar simple transformation property. actually, that transformation property is as follows. So action of representation from subgroup H tilde is reduced to multiplication with a character after we apply fiducial operator. So for reasons which we will explain soon, it's convenient to call induced covariant transform. And we will see what it's closely connected with so-called Perelomov cogerent states. So coming back to the case of the wavelet transform, which we consider it for the particular group G, and the fiducial operator is just the linear functional. Then we may pick up certain mother wavelets which has the transformational property being common eigenvector for all operators generated by subgroup H tilde. Then applying to the formula 49 the transformation, we may use group homomorphism property of representation to split this representation into two parts. Then for the part related to representation of rho on H, we know what action is reduced to the character, and then this character by linearity of inner product can be extracted to the factor in front of covariant transform. As a result, the image of the covariant transform has the transformational property, and of course we will immediately recognize what this is structural property which was specified in the condition 27 here. So in condition 27 we have this property to make an induced representation from subgroup tilde. So in this case our representation rho became intertwined with the representation which is induced from the subgroup tilde. So initially our representation may be induced from other subgroup. It's happen what the same representation can be induced from different subgroup and different characters. When its intertwining operator, covariant transform, provide an intertwining operator between this different form of induction. Similarly, we may restrict our attention to the values which are values of covariant transform which parameterized only by points of homogeneous space. So recall what we can embed points of homogeneous space into the group by means of chosen section, and then we are considering values of the covariant transform which generated by such points. So in particular, for the Fock-Segal-Bargmann transform, which we calculated in equation 33, we may choose the similar simplification. As we say, we drop out the trivial action by the center of the Heisenberg group, and we will obtain that formula which will be used in our further study as the canonical expression for the Fock-Segal-Bargmann transformation. So probably this is the right place to stop this lecture, and we will continue.